Since the conference is mainly international, so I will speak in English. First, I want to welcome you all. Thank you for coming, and assalamu alaikum. I want to apologize for the delay, especially to our special guest, the keynote speaker, and our guest, Zenza. We are honored here to have our third annual undergraduate conference at the International University of Sarajevo. This year, the conference name is Youth in Islam, and this conference is organized solely by students, and that is something which we are proud of. This year, however, we joined our forces with the Islamic Pedagogical University in Dževada, who helped us in organization. And our special thanks goes to Student Council and their respective professor, Esmi Halilovic, who accompanied them here. This year, the conference will be centered around Islamic youth. Together, we will examine issues of the contemporary world, how Islam aims to solve them, and what is the role of young, prosperous Muslims in finding solutions to some problems. Our special guest today, as I mentioned, is director of the Institute for Islamic Bosnian Tradition, Dr. Šuško. She's an exceptional woman who aims to promote Islamic traditional and Bosnian tradition, and who can serve us as a Muslim female woman. She will honor us with her introductory speech, so please welcome her on stage.
Belong to the Hanafi method,
that there are linguistic similarities, lots of Turkish words as well in Bosnian language, and similarities as well in terms of to food, to urban architecture, and culture. Then we have the Persian cultural zone, where we have such as Iran, India, and Central Asia, where we have predominantly Shia Muslims. Then we have the Arab cultural zone, where Arabic language is the language of the daily vernacular, the language of everyday communication. We have the Malaysian cultural zone in Southeastern Asia, and we have the African Muslim cultural zone. All these societies below or southern of the desert Sahara. So Muslims in Europe, and Muslims in the West as well in general, do belong to all these different cultural zones. And all of them, wherever they live, wherever they migrate, they take usually these understandings and interpretations of Islam and their cultural heritage with them. However, now the second, third, and fourth generation of Muslims living in the West, living in Europe, they gradually start to develop a new European Muslim identity. Ever since Salman Rushdie's Satanic Verses novel that Salman Rushdie, who was originally from Iran, wrote, published his book in the United Kingdom, upon which Iran issued fatwa and offered a bounty for the death of the author in 1989. And then in the 1990s, with the collapse of communism, disintegration of the Soviet Union, of the main enemy at that point of time, this context, these circumstances asked for a new enemy. In addition to that, several terrorist attacks that were linked with so-called Muslims and never-ending Muslim refugee waves, which the Muslim refugees who tried to set foot in the West, and then unsuccessful revolutions in the Middle East, the wars in Iraq, in Syria. With all these developments, Islam and Muslims became a growing interest. On the one side, the number of Islamic studies in Western universities grew and increased, and the translations of the Quran in different languages were very attractive to readers, and we have as well as a reaction many converts or reverts to Islam. On the other side, unfortunately, Muslims were perceived as potential danger and scapegoat in Europe and elsewhere in the West. Hence, the term Islamophobia or intolerance towards Muslims was coined. Islamophobia means fear and hatred towards Muslims and Islam, which is presented in such a way that it implies a negative image of both of Islam and Muslims. However, we have to be aware that Islamophobia is not when somebody disagrees with a Muslim leader, with a Muslim politician, with Muslim states, dominant Muslim societies, or even disagrees with Islam. This is not Islamophobia. We have to allow critical mind of the other who have a different worldview, who have a different point of view. Islamophobia, we can follow and trace Islamophobia in several publications, in movies, even in computer games. There is even pornography that was published on the detriment of Islam and Muslims. We have as well Inquisition ceremonies in Spain, for example, festivals, and arts. In all these fields, we have traits of intolerance towards Muslims and Islam. Together with Islamophobia goes a rising extreme right-wing populist movement all over the West, particularly in Europe. We have a rising number of political parties who won their seats in Parliament and their representatives are even running for president, such as recently in France with Marine Le Pen. And they are gaining lots of votes due to their anti-Muslim and anti-immigrant rhetoric. Furthermore, double standards are applied when it comes to human rights. While many Muslim girls and women are denied to practice their religion, are denied and discriminated to wear a headscarf, others can enjoy full freedom of faith. Thus, in the beginning of the 21st century, and we are in that time, European Muslims are facing what the Jews did 100 years ago, in the beginning of the 20th century. We hope and pray that history will not repeat itself. However, the warning lights are on. So it's up to us to prepare ourselves for the challenges of falling kids, particularly you as our youth, has to be aware of these challenges. And I would like to address the issue of work ethics, which we call in Islamic terminology akhlaq, a term originally from Arabic language and goes back to the word halaqa, which means to form, to create. So I had the privilege to grow up in Germany, in southwestern Germany, a region, Schwabenland, that is known for its working discipline. Anybody work in Germany? So the southwestern part of Germany is really known for a very disciplined German population, and I adopted lots of these values. To be on time, such as our conference, we were 5 minutes late, to work hard, to follow your obligations and duties, to respect the law, to be sincere and honest, to tell the truth, never give up when you set your goals, to serve your community, to love your country, to care about nature and those who are in need. And does this sound familiar to you?
I hope so, yes.
Because these are not southwestern origin German principles and skills or values. These are universal principles. These are Islamic principles. But we lost them. I lived now in Bosnia the last 12 years. And I worked at this precious university at IUS for 7 years. In the last 4 years, I served my community, Islamic Kazains and Islamic community. And I realized that we are far, far away from Islamic work ethics. And I would like to raise the awareness among you that work ethics are the basics, that are the precondition for a successful society, for a successful nation. There is a supplication of the Messenger of Allah when he asks Allah to save him, to preserve him from laziness and unemployment or worthlessness. Because Islam is a religion of action. Islam is a religion of work, of hard work, of movement. In the Quran, let's say 360 times the word amal, work, is mentioned. So work is ibadah, is serving God, is seeking the pleasure. And often we hear here in Bosnia and Herzegovina the sentence like, it's not worth trying, it doesn't pay off. Well, an ayah in the Quran says the contrary. It says that there is the imperative saying, work, try hard, be assertive, and your effort will be seen by whom? By, does anybody know? By God, Allah, by the Messenger, and the believers. So there is no work that doesn't pay off. There is no effort that is just done for nothing. So every single effort you put to
to learn, to expand your knowledge, to study, to earn money makes sense. And there is another hikaya or a saying related to the Prophet Isa alayhi salam. He observed a man who was very religious, very pious. He saw him always in the mosque, performing his prayers, fasting a lot, performing the zikr. Then he asked him, how do you earn your money? How do you live? How do you earn a living? And his pious man said, well, my brother, he feeds me. He works for me. And then he said, well, then your brother is more religious than you are. He's more pious than you are. So his brother who is earning, who is feeding, is more religious than the one who is on the point. And this shows that we in Islam have to care about the balance between dunya and akhir, between this life and the life after. So we have to balance this, both duties and obligations. And one of a very influential Muslim scholar, as I quoted him initially, Sayyid Hussein Nasser, he claims that Muslims must strictly obey to their world duties. They must seek for perfection and seek for results. So it's not about perform your work, but you have your goal must be that there are going to be results. And he talks as well very much about time management. Time is very precious in Islam. Mm-hmm. And you know, time management is a branch in when you study economy, and even lots of employers in the West ask their employees to organize their time efficiently. And Sayyid Hussein Nasser said, you have to, one third of your time that you have must be linked with work, with study, with any kind of work. One third of the time you must spend with working. One third of the time you must spend sleeping, because your body has as well a right to rest. And one third of the rest of the time, the last third, you have to spend prayers, spending time with your family, with your relatives, and with society activities. Today, we live in a world of an intense spiritual, intellectual, and political crisis. It is an era of an exaggerated individuality in thought and behaviors. Personal interests are above common interests. We have an inhuman capitalism. Only material gain and wealth is valued. Everything else does not matter. We have an aggressive neoliberalism. The wealthy become wealthier on the detriment of the poor, who become even poorer. We have wars all over the world, where Muslims, I believe, are the largest victims. In Iraq, in Syria, in Afghanistan, Turkey, Myanmar, Kashmir, Yemen, and so on and so forth. And we do have an identity crisis. We have a disorientation of Muslims. Where are Muslims heading to, towards the West? Should they stay in their home where their life is in danger? What are we actually? And we have as well attempts to impose new teachings of Islam here in Bosnia and Herzegovina and elsewhere, so-called neo-Salafi movements or Khariji. And we need responses. How to understand the Quran and Sunnah today? Because the Quran is, we need to be reinterpreted again and again. We're not talking about changing it, but we need new interpretations of these two constant sources of Islam. How to regain the positive image of Islam and Muslims? How to be an equal partner and citizen in today's world and still keep your Islamic identity? And what to do with all these questions, with all these circumstances, with all these challenges? And this includes as well, and I have listed 17 inclusive responses and tasks for you to do. Muslims need to know that they live in a modern world with its powerful technology, with the internet, and as well its powerful economy, which cannot be exchanged with the golden era or the first generation of Islam. Muslims must discover and rebuild a living Islam, a lively Islam in this modern world. Muslims have to define their own ways of modernity in a qualitative connection of tradition and today's time. An interaction of, and please keep this in mind, of faith, of knowledge, of tradition, and innovation. So, my first imperative to you is make your choice for lifelong learning. So when you finish your first degree, don't say, I'm now fed up with books, I'll throw them all away. No. Islam asks from us. We Muslims are supposed to learn our whole life, as long as we live, to learn, to expand our knowledge, and to expand our horizons. To acquire as well new skills. Acknowledging all kinds of fields, but to be a specialist in our field of knowledge, but as well expand the knowledge in other fields. We have to be always among the best. And there is no alternative for Muslims than perfection. There is no space, and we do not have the luxury for mediocrity. We have to be as well assertive of common universal heritage of Muslims, as well Christians and Jews, such as love of your neighbor, to serve God, to be honest, to be diligent in hardworking, to seek knowledge, to seek for social justice and raise your voice when you see that social justice is not met, to care for the needy, to fight for freedom of faith, and you have the right for it. To call for non-violence, we need to call for peace. And to spread peace and harmony. Fourthly, it is our task to correct the wrong image of Muslims as violent, barbaric, and uncivilized people. We have to research and understand the positive role of Muslims that they had for centuries. Academic books, for example, were translated from Arabic language in medieval times into Latin and were used at European universities. We have to be as well assertive in claiming that Islam and democracy are compatible, that the rule of law is an integral part of Islam, that Muslims are obliged and must obey the constitution, the law, rules, and contracts that of the country they live in. Human rights and minority rights is something which is included in the very first documents of the first generation of Islam. In the human rights are based in the Quran, in the Meccan and Medina society, all in all these societies. It was clearly shown that freedom of religion is inherent, is an integral part of Islam and Muslims. For example, the Medina constitution included as well the rights of Jews. The Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam, he gave the Jewish population in Medina their religious freedom and their rights. And early Sharia law granted as well to non-Muslims not only religious rights, as well political and citizens' rights. For example, they were allowed to trade with alcohol and pork. The Yazidi population had public function. We had ministers and judges of other religions. Seven, we have to be a part, an integral part. We have to participate in societal and political life. You are expected to be involved in political parties, to represent the population in municipalities, or federal parliaments, or state parliaments, to be involved as well in non-governmental organizations, in human rights movements, and movements as well that care about the nature, to preserve the balance that God has created when it comes to the nature. And when you fight for your rights, when you represent the citizens who voted for you, if you become a politician, then you have to talk in a way that others understand you. And this counts as well for those who are active in interreligious dialogue, or for those who live in the West, when the majority are non-Muslims. And as Tariq Ramadan said, if they don't get you, if they don't understand you, then it's your problem. So we have to become understandable when we're seeking for our rights. We have to broaden as well our knowledge about Islam as a religion and culture and lifestyle to be able to discuss qualitatively about our religion. If we do not have a broad education, a deep education about Islam, then we cannot, we don't have enough arguments and knowledge to discuss about Islam. We have to be as well open for discussions, for particular research projects as scholars. We have to be open for interreligious dialogue, where all sides are gathered, as well those who disagree with us. Very often we only meet with people who share the same opinion with us. This is fine, you can relax. But actually the real challenge is to discuss and oppose a person who has a totally different point of view. And try to find a synthesis, try to find a compromise. Try to make yourself understandable, that the other side at least understands you, even if the other side disagrees with you. Take a more proactive role in representing yourself as harmless citizens. As today, unfortunately, we are facing that Muslims are considered mainly as violent, extremist people. So this is important that we represent ourselves as harmless citizens. And when your rights as a practicing Muslim are deprived, when you feel discriminated, when you feel that you're not allowed to practice your religion, then use the legal path. Go the legal path. Particularly using then the International Convention for the Protection of Human Rights. Within this convention, among others, freedom of faith is an integral part, and it says there are two parts of it. It says that every person has the right to choose his or her religion. Every person has the right to practice his or her, to get a religious education and to celebrate religion in private and public. This is what's clearly stated, in private and in public, individually and collectively. The state has the right to not to grant you this right, but why? The state has, if your religious practice endangers the security of the state, or morals, or health of the state, then the state has the right to reduce your freedom of faith, to reduce religious freedom, but with the help of a law. So a law must be passed and arguments must be given that your religious practice, and particularly in the West now, is the topic is the headscarf. So far the headscarf hasn't been endangered either to the security, nor to the morals, nor to the health of society. So go the legal path. Demonstrations are fine, petitions are fine, but in the end, they will not change the situation. Go the legal path, go in front of court, use lawyers, and go in front of the court and ask for your rights. And even this Convention for the Protection of Human Rights, in every country which is a member of the OSCE, and anyway, EU member state, including Bosnia and Herzegovina is a member of the OSCE, all these conventions are above the domestic law. And have the right, have the supremacy to be over all the domestic laws. And when it comes to the headscarf, I mentioned this again and again, headscarf is not a religious symbol. headscarf is not a symbol of Islam. Because with symbols, you may use them or you may not use them. Symbols are not obligatory. Headscarf is religious practice. It has its roots in the Quran and in the Sunnah, which are the two most important sources in Islam. And it's religious practice. And according to the Quran, if you follow this line of argumentation, then headscarf is protected within the convention for protection of human rights. Face Islamophobia rationally and not violently. And use the same means of communication. So, I mentioned in this example, where you remember this probably a decade ago, when the cartoons appeared in Denmark. Dylan's Boston cartoons, which are showing the Prophet Muhammad in a very negative way, very negatively. And there were huge demonstrations all over the world, burning down the Danish flag, demonstrations in front of the Danish embassies, and so on and so forth, which are fine. But in the end, the real message is to use the same means of communicating. So when the cartoons appear, which show something which is very precious for us, and where we are very sensitive, then we have to place cartoons as well, which show this issue on the way how we see it, our perspective. If a movie is issued that shows our the Prophet Muhammad and Islam, or Islam in a negative way, then we have to make a movie which shows our perspective. We use the same means of communication, just your perspective. Do not allow that others are forming the story about Islam and Muslims. We have the right as well to form and to present our perspective. So find ways to make it clear to the other side that Muslims are especially sensitive and vulnerable regarding the Quran and the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam, and as well vulnerable to when it comes to mosques. Ignore provocations. Provocations are made for you to react in a violent way. So ignore them. Adhere to the seven C's that Tariq Ramadan presented. So, seven C's. Confidence. Muslims shall be confident when it comes to their Islamic values. To be consistent, meaning that Muslims should be consistent when it comes to the realization of their goals. Critical mind. Muslims are not allowed to follow blindly to some preachers, to some scholars, to some politicians. We are supposed to develop our own point of view and to question. Do not read a text and just accept it like this. Question a text, question a lecture, question a scholar, question a politician to develop your critical mind. Communication. We have to communicate more about our perspective, about our point of view. Contribution. Do we all contribute to our society, to our neighborhood, to the betterment of the state where all of us are living? So each of us, we have to question ourselves. Do we give enough of our knowledge, time, experience, for the betterment of our society? Citizenship, meaning that we have to become citizens who have a high level of awareness of what is happening around us. And creativity. Muslims need to make new solutions, new approaches. You have to give new ideas. And with creativity, you're opening new doors, you're opening new ways, new paths. So these are the seven C's that Tariq Ramadan has presented several years ago. And finally, this is my last point. I am addressing all of you individually. Be the one who will make a change. Discover and strengthen your competencies. Search for opportunities. Travel and expand your horizons. Be the one who will launch a chain reaction for the benefit of youth in Islam. Thank you. Thank you.
for example, how would you rate Bosnian Muslims in terms of all Muslims in the world when it comes to the hard work, dedication, work ethic that you mentioned? Where is that?
Well, I haven't done research to make ranking of where do we
stand.
I would think my estimation is that Bosnian Muslims are on the top, because we still, even if we are developing country, Bosnia and Herzegovina is an underdeveloped country, where instable political system, instable economic system, but still, when it comes to education and knowledge, the parents do not hinder their children to get an education. What I'm worried about is the quality. Because I have been a university professor, and I'm worried about whether Muslim students indeed seek perfection, whether they really not cheat at exams. So this is something, I'm talking about where we are losing values in terms of sincerity, honesty. So we are enrolled at university. We do finish. We talk even about an overproduction of bachelor and master degrees, which is good as long as these degrees are highly qualitative and as long as these know what they're going to make out of it. But if we just for the benefit of getting a diploma, then this seeking of knowledge is doesn't make sense. So we are investing in knowledge and in education, but we should as well focus very much on quality and of taking the opportunity to go and study abroad. This is my experience that I have with most of our students. They are kind of hesitant to take a scholarship either in Turkey or somewhere else. We're very much, let's stay at home with your parents, with our friends. But as long as you do not travel, you will not be able to see the world with different eyes. When you start traveling, you broaden your mind and you start seeing the world with different eyes. And you become a more mature citizen, a more mature personality. If you are born in one country and you get all your education, I know for some of you, perhaps there was no opportunity, but as far as I know, there are many opportunities to get a scholarship for a master's degree, or at least to stay for a couple of months. Now, I know IUS is well involved in an Erasmus program, isn't it? So this is my ideal opportunity to stay there at least for one semester to get an experience outside of your home country. And this is as well, for any modern employer, when they see in your CV that you have done one semester, or that you have finished abroad, or when you finish your master's degree somewhere abroad, this is actually shows how mature you are, that you're very ambitious, that you want to learn, and that you are willing to take a challenge, because it's a challenge to go abroad, to end up somewhere in the airport in a foreign country. It is a challenge. So that you are capable of facing challenges and if you want to move forward. So my advice to you is as well at the end, travel as much as you can. Yes?
Unfortunately, we have many examples of that young people are very passive. Do you have some suggestions how to change it, and do you have any idea why is it like that? Because we truly have a big role. We can make a change, but somehow we're not doing it.
I think I mentioned this several times now in my lecture that it's about a lack of awareness. What is it to be a Muslim? If you are passive and you think it's not worth engaging, but it doesn't make sense, then actually there's something wrong with your iman. Because you have to be, Islam asks from us to be active, to be involved, to be engaged, to learn, to seek knowledge, to contribute, to move forward. Passivity is indeed a loss of values, a loss of iman. So this is a problem about religiosity and about that we lost this feeling of setting goals. There is a saying, shoot for the moon, set high goals. two of us is going to end up in the US. One or two of us, if at all. But this is, you know, metaphorically, shoot for the moon, and even if you miss it, you will land among the stars. This is it. We have to learn to shoot for high goals. And even if we do not meet this goal, at least the goals below are as well success. So we lost this feeling of making a strategic plan, of making a plan for the coming 5 years, to put all your efforts to apply for all kinds of scholarships, opportunities, and then when you get one, make the right selection and accept it. Don't be hesitant to accept the challenge. Is this what we did? That many of us became becoming lazy, you know? We rather like to drink coffee, and you see it here in Sarajevo in the middle of the day, during working hours, during study hours, the coffee shops are full. This is a sign that people are not working enough, are not devoted enough to do their duties. Whether this might be high school, university, employees, whatever it is. So each of us individually have to ask ourselves, to look at us in the mirror and see, am I really on the right path? What am I doing? To what extent am I giving my contribution? Have I learned properly? Have I cheated on the exam? This is a severe mistake and such a loss of values. So we have to look at ourselves and see how we are and what are we doing. Yes, there is one question.
Yeah. Can I ask, what do you think, how much and on which level stereotyping and prejudice is based on the first impression of maybe physical appearance prevent Muslims from communicating to each other and or accepting them as one of their own?
So the first, and this is the outer identity. If you see somebody and you're establishing prejudice, so you're going from a Muslim to a Muslim.
Does it even worsen our internal communication and gives other chance to take advantage of that? To you know, is that even worsening contributing, you know, to this stagnation?
Well, generally we should not judge somebody on their the way he or she looks like. I mean, this is not correct and it's not the right way. So we have to enter a dialogue to see what the other thinks, believes, does. We have to judge somebody according to his deeds, what he's doing, what he or she is doing.
Since we know that is a problem in today's society, especially society of our own, do you think that even that it contributes, you know, to this stagnation of our part of the population?
That we are judging someone according to the first?
Maybe having some, putting some blocks, you know.
Well, we should put some blocks, as I said. We should communicate as much as we can. Communicate, exchange, enter in a dialogue, be sincere, talk to each other, not judging. Stereotyping doesn't lead us to anywhere. It just leads us to raising barriers, raising walls among us. It's very important to enter this dialogue, to accept the other the way he or she is, even if there are different opinions. I mean, the world is made, it's human to have different perceptions, to have different opinions, to have different standpoints. But we all should gather and focus on what we have together. And even Muslims and non-Muslims have so many things together. And among us Muslims, we have even much more things that we share. So we should focus on these matters that we share, that we have in common, and not focus too much on what differs, where we differ, because we do differ. We are individuals. We are each of us carries a personality on his and her own. But I'm sorry, I have to interrupt because I have a press conference at 11:30 in downtown, and I need to drive back to downtown. I thank you very much for your discussion, and I wish you sincerely the very best.